Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, as we bow our head and hearts to you, we just want to thank you for this time to get to know you more, that we can gather and grow in your word, Lord. So just let your word grow in our hearts and minds, and just have your hand upon each and every one of us in this house. And thank you for everything. Forgive us the sins known and unknown. Most of all, let your will be done. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Hallelujah, all I have is Christ, hallelujah, Jesus is my life. I once was lost in darkest night, yet thought I knew the way. The sin that promised joy and life had led me to the grave. I had no hope that you would own a rebel to your will. And if you had not loved me first, I would refuse you still. But as I ran my hell-bound race, indifferent to the cost, you looked upon my helpless state and led me to the cross. And I beheld God's love displayed. You suffered in my place. You bore the wrath reserved for me. Now all I know is grace. Hallelujah. All I have is Christ. Hallelujah. Jesus is my life. Hallelujah. All I have is Christ. Hallelujah. Jesus is my life. Now, Lord, I would be yours alone and live so all might see the strength to follow your commands could never come from me. Oh, Father, use my ransom life in any way you choose. And let my song forever be my only boast is you. Hallelujah. All I have is Christ. Hallelujah. Jesus is my life. Hallelujah. All I have is Christ. Hallelujah. Jesus is my life. Hallelujah. All I have is Christ. Hallelujah. Jesus is my life.
Amen.
You feel the world is broken. Do you feel the shadows deepen? Do you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through? Do you wish that you could see it all made new? is all creation growing? It is a new creation coming? It is the glory of the Lord to be the light within our midst? It is it good that we remind ourselves of this? It is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, he is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy of this? He is. Does a Father truly love us? He does. Does the Spirit move among us? He does. And does Jesus our Messiah hold forever those He loves? He does. Does our God intend to dwell again with us? He does. Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, he is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. For every people and tribe, every nation and tongue, he has made us a kingdom and priest to God to reign with the Son. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy? Is he worthy? Is he worthy of this? He is.
Past the brazen altar,
Lord, I want to see your face. Pass me by the crowds of people and the priests to sing your praise. Lord, I hunger and thirst for your righteousness, and it's only found one place. Take me into the holy of holies. Take me in by the blood of the Lamb. Take me into the holy of holies. Take the coal, touch my lips. Here I am. So take the coal, touch my lips. Here I am.
Thank you, Lord. All right, guys.
How are you tonight?
Good.
We're going to look at a few passages tonight, but what I want to talk about are the gifts of the Spirit and the fruit of the Spirit, and ask ourselves, though we need both, what is the most important? The gifts of the Spirit or the fruit of the Spirit? And of course, I think all of us in this building tonight would say the fruit is the most important, because the fruit of the Spirit will be that which lasts forever, where the gifts are temporary, so that we might be effective witnesses for Christ and the church might be built up by those spiritual gifts. And I do believe that Paul in 1 Corinthians 13 covers that. Now tonight, I'm going to give, in a sense, a message in an apologetic approach, because we're covering topics that you're going to get different ideas in the body of Christ. And these things should never be issues of unity. And so we need to be respectful in the different ideas that people have when it comes to spiritual gifts and to the fruit of the Spirit, recognizing, even though we may not fully agree, these should never be issues for unity. We can still have unity, even though we might have a difference of opinion or a different conviction on the gifts of the Spirit, right? Thank God. That means we can hang out with Baptists, and you can even hang out with some crazy charismatics, as long as they don't get too crazy and the Baptists don't get too legalistic, we'll be okay. But what is more important, gifts or fruit? The Bible teaches the existence of all spiritual gifts, regardless of what position you might be. I believe in the body of Christ, we have basically two different representations. We have continuationists, right, who believe that all the gifts continue. And we have the cessationists, who believe that certain gifts have ceased. Where do I stand on that? I'll tell you where I stand on that. I would have to be a very mild cessationist, not full-blown, because nothing's impossible with God. My problem with a full-blown cessationist is that we could be in danger of limiting God in our mind and in our thought processes, where if you look at the Bible carefully, there can be no more apostles, capital A. Why can there be no more apostles, capital A? And that was the qualification that Peter gave in the book of Acts, wasn't it? It's like, let us pick out an apostle who has been with us from the baptism of John till the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Amen. And so that was a requirement. So apostle, capital A, has ceased, because it was more of a ministerial gift that was limited by time, and a foundation had to be laid in the church. So even the most wildest continuationists surely would have to admit that, but unfortunately we do have movements today where we have professing apostles capital A. And of course, in order to be apostles capital A, they all have to claim that they've had a trip to heaven. They've seen Jesus in some way, you know. And unfortunately, very often it negates any supernatural encounter that anyone can have with God because of the crazy way that they approach it. And you know, what they're teaching and what they're seeing isn't correct. So also another gift that has ceased is the writing of Scripture. The writing of Scripture has ceased. Genesis to Revelation has been God's entrusted revelation to us. So we could say, you know, if you wish to be a continuationist today, you have to be a mild cessationist, if you look at it correctly, because there's no more Scripture. There's no more Apostle capital A. I think every one of us in this room would agree on that, right? Those of us who come here, we understand that. So I hate to break it to you. That makes you a cessationist. I'm just saying.
Not full blown,
amen. So, but it's good to know what you believe, right? It's good to have a conviction, and we're not going to always entirely agree, but I think we're all in agreement on that. Amen. The groups that have risen up since then that have continuing apostles in their movement, apostles capital A, are being dysfunctional. Because what they're trying to do, they're trying to relay the foundation over and over and over again. It's already been laid once. Those who introduce new Scripture, they're overdoing it because Scripture's already been written. It's done. Holy Scripture's been done. There's not going to be a fourth book of John, a fourth epistle of John, or a second epistle of Jude. No matter how much they do archaeological diggings, it's not going to be done. Because those who are a lot closer to the time confirmed what the canon or the measurement of Scripture was, and what you have in your Bible, Genesis to Revelation, is an accurate reflection of a lot of historical thought processes and accepting or rejecting that which came from God as Scripture and that which did not. So if we move away from Genesis to Revelation, we are moving away from that which has already been decided in the church from those who are much closer to the original. So anyway, I would say that every believer ought to be a mild cessationist at very least. Right? Good. Hey, we're learning something. We're actually in agreement on that, which I think is cool. So, regardless of what we might believe, whether we are cessationists or continuationists, I misspelled that, each group believes all the gifts mentioned in Scripture were authentic at some point, right? When you read the Bible, even the most strictest cessationist has to admit there was such a thing as the gift of tongues, right? It's funny how the least important, I think, of all the gifts has become the most controversial. Just like human beings to do that. Yeah, let's take something minor and let's make it a major issue and let's make this a divisive point. And I think it unfortunately shows our immaturity when we do that.
Yes,
that we make something not critical to salvation, a divisive issue. And because speaking in tongues is not essential for salvation, then we shouldn't divide over it.
That's right.
Right? Why do we divide over it, do you think? Do you think it's because we make it more important than it really is? I think so. Both sides, not just those who think, you know, that they have speaking in tongues and they judge you for not speaking in tongues, but the other side who completely blackball the whole thing and say it's not right and it's evil, it's bad. No, I think regardless of what you believe with tongues, There are real, genuine Christians who genuinely believe they speak in tongues. And they're not doing that from the devil because they have the Holy Spirit in them. Now, whether you think that gift is authentic or not, you definitely can't say they're doing it by the devil because they're Christian. They love the Lord. So we can at least give that allowance, no matter how staunch you might be, whether the gift of tongues exists today or not, right?
No, it wouldn't be in the Bible.
That's right.
Amen.
It's in the Bible. Yeah. Amen. We can argue over, are we practicing it correctly? Is what we have now the exact thing that they had back then? We could argue over that. But we should never say that a fellow Christian is doing it by demonization. Although we do know there are some wicked teachers out there who it makes us wonder.
Yes.
Who are teaching the doctrines of demons, doctrines of devils. And yes, we have to say very often there can be an evil source. So, let's go to 1 Corinthians 13, verse 1. And let's look at this from the standpoint of agape and love. Now, the Apostle Paul, who did speak in tongues himself, he claimed to have the gift of tongues, right? The Apostle Paul. Now, the question is what we're practicing now in much of our circles, is it exactly what Paul did then? That's up for research. That's up for discussion. But regardless of what we believe about it, Paul definitely spoke in tongues. Right? Without a doubt. But Paul did say this. If I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. Some of us who have gone to churches who majorly practice speaking in tongues, we said, yep, I know all about the noisy gong and the clanging cymbal. Been there, done that. Unfortunately, I was one of the clanging cymbals. And without love, the gifts are nothing. That's what we have to remember. So even if you believe you have a gift of tongues, if you're not operating in love, it loses its value. In fact, I hate to break it to you like this. If we don't operate in love, any gift that we operate in has absolutely no value because it's not being done through the fruit of the Holy Spirit. And there will be no reward for that gift because you weren't operating in love. Now, examining the sources here, the first place that the gift of tongues was manifest, it may surprise you, is in Genesis chapter 11, the Tower of Babel. Genesis chapter 11, verses 6 through 9. That's where I think Scottish came from, is the Tower of Babel. I still don't understand them to this day, and I'm from the same British Isles. And I lived in Scotland for at least 4 years. But they were building the Tower of Babel, and of course, we use the term Babel as babbling on, don't we, now, which I think is ironic. Confusion is what Babel means, or Babel means. But no, it says, and the Lord said, behold, they are one people, and they have all one language. So there was a time in human history when all human beings spoke only one language. Now, we've confirmed it could have been the King James English. No, we're just kidding. I sent Norbert a fun thing on Facebook, and it said, any honest Bible commentator would surely tell you that the original language was the King James language before Babel happened. Thus saith the Lord, and peradventure, it may be true. No, it isn't. We're kidding. So they did have one language. We don't know what language that was, but everyone understood each other. That was a gift from God too. Because when God created human beings, he gave us the ability to speak. He gave us the ability to think, to talk, to reason. That came from God. So God is the author of the gift of speech. He's the author of the gift of language. He's the author of the gift of thought and reason and intellect and understanding. And here's a thought. If all this came from God, then he has the right to change it, if he so chooses. So, he said that, and this is only the beginning of what they will do, and nothing that they propose to do will now be impossible for them. Come, let us. There's deeper evidence for the Trinity right there. Again, let me reiterate, let us. Where do we first read that? In Genesis. Genesis 1:26. Let us make man in our own image, in our image. And here we have, let us go down. And there confuse their language, that they may not understand one another's speech. So the Lord dispersed them from there over the face of all the earth, and they left off building the city. Therefore its name was called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of all the earth. And from there the Lord dispersed them over the face of all the earth. So what happened here was, they were each put into their families, they were each put into their clans. So even though it looked confusing, there was actually a divine order taking place here. Because even though the different clans and the different peoples couldn't understand each other, the people from the same clan, from the same families, could understand one another. So God had a definite structure. What looked like confusion was God's order happening, because what that would force people to do is they had to hang out with people they understood, right? And that was where all these different languages on planet Earth came from. Now, of course, there is such a thing called language development, right? How many of you have an old Bible? I'm talking about Wycliffe, Geneva Bible, where you see the old English, the old spelling. English has changed drastically over the centuries. From 1611 on, it's changed again, right? Language is always changing. If you get a dictionary from the 1800s, and then you get a dictionary from 2021, you're going to see new words in there, especially dealing with computer and technology that wasn't there before. So words go under development. But here we see the origin of all human language was offered by God at the Tower of Babel. When I hear a Chinese person talking, I'm often amazed. Even though I don't understand the word they are saying, it's an amazing language to listen to. And you have to say, God gave that language, right? So, even English itself was so diverse that the one guy who said, we are a people divided by a common language. It's true. Even English is so diverse in its expression. That's because we were created in God's image, and we're creative in how we talk, right? Amen? Yeah, I mean, America, you can go to certain parts of America and not understand the word they're saying because of accents. So God is so diverse in this language issue. And I bring that out to show you who's in charge of speaking. It's God, but he allows a certain creativity in human beings, a certain expression. Another accent that I find amazing is the New England accent. I find that interesting. Sounds different. They came from England, you know, a lot of those New England people. But now they're speaking differently. It happens. So the Lord confused, and from there the Lord dispersed them over all the face of the earth. And so you see the different families put into different categorizations, right? And so God orchestrated that. God put them into different places. God gifted them with different languages. So we could say, in a reverse kind of way, that was a gift of tongues. right? From a creational standpoint, a common grace standpoint. Did you have something, Norbert?
No.
Oh, okay, I'm fine. Okay, yeah.
Green.
Okay, yeah. Now let's look at another place, and this will surprise you. Another place where the gift of tongues occurred is in the book of Numbers, Balaam's donkey. Just saying. Balaam's donkey was gifted with a gift of tongues. Think about it. Where do you think they got Mr. Ed from? Come on now. Nothing original, nothing new. I would say the difference with Mr. Ed and Balaam's donkey was Mr. Ed kept talking for the rest of his life. Of course, it was a fun movie. A fun show. And we're just going to look at Numbers 22 and 28 through 30. Here's the gift of tongues right here. Then the Lord opened the mouth of the donkey. Think about that. If the Lord can open the mouth of a donkey and make a donkey talk, nothing's impossible with God. Right? We see how in control he is of human language. To give, not only give the donkey speech, but for that brief moment, even give the donkey understanding to be able to communicate. Many of us are glad that our pets cannot talk. Because they would tell tales on us. For sure. I know Wilson would, without a doubt. He would tell us how his master treats him, and he would not be very happy always. So, then the Lord opened the mouth of the donkey, and she said to Balaam, "What have I done to you that you have struck me these three times?" Now, what I'm amazed about isn't that Balaam's donkey spoke, but the thing that really amazes me is when the donkey spoke, Balaam talked back to it without giving second thought. That really amazes me. But he was angry at that point, right? He had been beaten on it because it trapped his foot, because the donkey saw the angel of the Lord and knew that. And so the donkey was really trying to protect his owner. And for trying to protect his owner, Balaam, he gets a beating for it, right? He's like, "All I'm trying to do is serve you, and you're beating me. Stop it." He's a false prophet. And Balaam said to the donkey, "Because you have made a fool of me, I wish I had a sword in my hand, for then I would kill you." Wow. That's a loving pet owner, isn't it?
Yeah.
None of us have ever said that to our pets, I know. So, now here the conversation goes on. And the donkey said to Balaam, "Am I not your donkey on which you have ridden all your life long to this day? Is it my habit to treat you this way?" And he said, "No." So the donkey won the argument. That's another cool thing. The donkey won out. Was smarter than the false prophet. So this was a real gift of tongues. Now the reason why I bring this out is we should never limit God. Am I saying that you're going to go home tonight and your dog's going to talk? No, the chances of that happening are pretty slim. But God could do it if he chose, right? Now, here's another thing. I don't think Balaam's donkey kept talking after this issue. I think it was for that moment. Now, again, I'm not trying to defend cessationism when I say that. But I am saying in this case, the gift of this donkey talking ceased, right? I don't think after that the donkey kept talking. There's no evidence of that anyway, right? That donkey probably was never the same again after that experience. So another case where a gift of tongues was given, a donkey speaking in human language. Nothing's impossible with God. My only real beef against a full-blown cessationist is I think they limit God. And why I think they limit God is because of all the nonsense that does go on in the church, and we should have discernment, but we should never discount the possibility that God can do anything. That's why we pray. Through prayer, we've seen answers to prayer that baffle us, that bewilder us, but we have to say God has done that in answer to prayer, right? There comes a point when we have to accept that God hasn't changed. He's a miracle-working God. Now, those who are professing, the false preachers who are professing to operate in it, are false. We admit that. Well, they're given a false message as well on top of their miracle claims. If they were preaching Christ and Him crucified, we might be tempted to listen to them, but they're not. They're preaching themselves. So there's a bigger reason why you should reject their miracles. It's their false gospel, which I think is an even more serious issue than their false miracles. Because of, you know, only the true gospel is what we should embrace. I reached a point in the early 90s where there was these people claiming to raise all these people from the dead. I know God can do that, right? You know God can do that. God can do anything. But I reached a point where I said, unless these people are preaching Christ and Him crucified, I want nothing to do with them. I wasn't there when they claimed to raise someone from the dead, but I've heard their preaching and they are not preaching Christ and Him crucified. And if they're not preaching Christ and Him crucified, they're not following the pattern of the Apostle Paul when he said, "For I determined to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified." Amen. So if they're not preaching the gospel, I don't want anything to do with them. They got nothing for me if they're not preaching Christ and the cross and the gospel, you know. So anyway, let's go over to Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2, because here we see on the day of Pentecost, these people were granted a gift of tongues. This was what impacted the early church. And what they got, though, was understood by the people around them. If you can entertain this thought, the same people that were separated during the Tower of Babel, many of them regathered in Jerusalem from those same areas where they had gathered, and now God was gathering them back in under the unity of the gospel, the Holy Spirit. And at this moment, He was giving the Galileans a language that they had never learned. Think about that. They were speaking the glory of God in a language they never learned. Isn't that amazing? If we could draw an analogy, if the closest equivalent would be if you came across an Italian and they didn't know English and God permitted you to speak the gospel to them in the Italian language. That's what we're talking about here. So it says, when the day of Pentecost arrived, the feast, and so when the day of Pentecost had fully come, I prefer that translation because it shows the importance of these feasts as well in coordination with important events. They were all together in one place. Pentecost is 50. It's 50 days after Passover. So if you want a time sequence on that, it's 50 days after Jesus had been crucified and raised from the dead. 50 days. He appeared to them for 40 days, if you think about it, after He was resurrected. And they waited for 10 days in the upper room. So you have that 50-day period between Christ's resurrection, but 10 days from His ascension, because they looked up, they saw Him ascend into heaven. These angels showed up, men dressed in white, and they said, "You men of Galilee, why are you gazing up into the sky? Because this same Jesus who you saw go up will come again." So they're preaching the second coming. And Jesus had told them to wait in Jerusalem for the promise of the Father, and you will receive the Holy Spirit not many days hence. So 10 days after Jesus ascended into heaven, there they are, and you can read in Acts chapter 1 some of the things they did during that 40-day period. That's when they drew lots and replaced Judas Iscariot as one of the 12 apostles. So they were praying, they were fellowshipping, they were having Bible studies, and they were doing it for 10 days. Could you imagine doing a prayer meeting, Bible study, fellowship time for 10 whole days? Wouldn't that be wonderful?
That would be fun.
It would be fun. Something would happen. Either we'd get sick of each other, or the Lord would pour out his Spirit, right? One way or another. And that's what happened. They were praying, and when the day of Pentecost had fully come, that's when God chose to pour out his Spirit, coinciding with the feast day. And Pentecost is the spring harvest, the first harvest of the year, the spring harvest. And so here we have a harvest of souls getting ready to be brought in. Now, this was when the church was birthed, the New Testament church was birthed into existence by an outpouring and filling of God's Holy Spirit. And by golly, if the church was birthed by the Holy Spirit, we need the continuation of the presence and person of the Holy Spirit in the church to continue on, don't we? We need him. So when the day of Pentecost arrived, they were all together in one place. And suddenly there came from heaven a sound like a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Notice they weren't jumping around and dancing and rolling down the aisle. They were sitting when the Spirit came, right? They were sitting, and the Spirit came and fell upon them and filled them. And they got everything in that moment. It's like they were baptized and they were filled. The Spirit rested upon them. And so they were filled with all the fruits of the Spirit. And they, each one was equipped with a particular gifting from the Holy Spirit to be able to perform ministry. Right? The gifts are for ministry, and the fruit of the Spirit is for our Christ-likeness, our growth in him. And from the same Holy Spirit, but for a different purpose. We need the gifts of the Spirit in order to function correctly. So, but they were sitting. And notice it said, and divided tongues as a fire appeared to them and rested on each one of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. So they were given a release into languages they had never learned. And the beautiful thing about this encounter was when they began to go out into the streets from the upper room, there was a gathering of Jews because of the day of Pentecost. And they saw all these Galileans. The only thing I can say why they knew they were Galileans, they must have dressed differently, right? The fishermen, they dress a little differently. A little more rugged, you might say. Can you often recognize, even in America, people who've come from certain parts of the States? Do you have that look about you sometimes where you're like... Uh-huh. Well, sometimes you look at the car and you say, well, there's a redneck, you know? Because of how they have it. Have you ever seen those funny things on Facebook?
Yeah.
The things that the rednecks put together. It's like, yeah. And we love rednecks.
Amen.
They give us a good laugh. We love them dearly. What's that?
Thank you.
Amen. So, but very often you can tell. And back then, there's probably a greater distinction than there is now of where you came from. Now there's more of a melting pot, I think, happening. So they began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. So for the first time, they're speaking in languages they had never learned before. Now, what were they speaking? Let's go over to the next verse. Now, there were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews. They were there for this very important feast. Devout men from every nation under heaven. And at this sound, the multitude came together. So about 120, and there was a sound, the sound of the rushing mighty wind. Perhaps they heard it. something unusual was taking place. The sound of a rushing mighty wind that came from heaven. And then these people who were speaking in new languages, they heard it. And so at this sound, the multitude came together. What are tongues a sign for? Unbelievers. And by the tongues, I'm talking about these tongues here, because they were given a gift of speech that they did not know previously, that these people understood. They were speaking a language they had not learned, but a language that they actually knew. And that got their attention, and they're proclaiming the glory of God in this newfound language that they were granted. And let's read on. So it says, and they were bewildered. This is why they were bewildered, because each one was hearing them speak in his own language. Imagine that. I know when I took French in England, I wish I had the gift of tongues. It would have helped. I would have got an A+, but instead I think I got a B-. But anyway. They heard them speak in his own language, and they were amazed and astonished, saying, are not all these who are speaking Galileans? They knew they were Galileans, right? Here's a miracle, right? If I've never learned French, let's just make this proposition. French is a very difficult language to speak. And if me all of a sudden in my weird English accent all of a sudden start breaking forth in perfect French, I'm talking about accents and everything, getting it all just correct, then you know something weird is going on, right? Right?
Right. Yes.
And you're a French person and you understand. It's like, from whence did he learn this perfect French? He's an Englishman. He's from Manchester. He can't speak like that. That's what we're talking about, to give the analogy. Not only were they given a new language, they were given the ability to speak it forth perfectly. In a way that it got their attention. They're like, these men are Galileans, and why are we hearing them speaking our language? And not only are they speaking our language, they're proclaiming the wonderful works of God. Talk about a perfect sermon when you're not in control of what you're really saying. And it's the Holy Spirit that's gifted you this language. And they're hearing this gospel come forth. And Peter gets up as a spokesperson. And he gives the bulletin issue of what these people, I believe, are actually saying already as they're declaring the wonderful works of God in newfound tongues. Peter gets up as the spokesperson, preaches the gospel to them. The Holy Spirit is in operation. He pierces their heart. And they say, men and brethren, what should we do? And he says, repent, be baptized. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. And so the Holy Spirit was in definite operation here, and he used tongues. Now notice here, we are given some of the languages in which were granted. Now here's a thought. This was no loose, slipshod thing, just like in Babel, the Tower of Babel. God designated certain languages to certain people. And even though if I was present on Babel and you were, it would have looked complete confusion. God had a definite order set up, didn't he? This family over here, this clan over here, these people over here, and disperse them into different places, different locations. Let's read this. And how is it that we hear each of us in his own native language? These were Jews who were born in different countries and learned different languages, but not the Galileans, and they knew that. Parthians and Medes and Elamites and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia, these words are hard to say, and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans, I like that term, Cretans, and Arabians, we hear them telling in our own tongues the mighty works of God. Wonderful, huh? Wonderful. And all were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But others mocking said, "They are filled with new wine." So this gift was given for a real purpose. It was given to get the attention of the unbelievers, these Galileans, or this English person is speaking perfect French. There has to be a problem here. What's going on? Now we go back here to 1 Corinthians 13, and we see the love of God is the key to any gift. Because Paul said, "If I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal." So again, it answers our question that the most important thing is the fruit of the Spirit, even more so than the gift of the Spirit. Because the gift of the Spirit is needed, gifts of the Spirit are needed, but it's more important that those gifts get used correctly, right? For the sake. So that's the first one we've looked at here. Let's go over to 1 Corinthians 13, verse 2. Now, the thing that makes me a mild cessationist and not a full-blown cessationist is this. Apologia Ministries talked about a time when a guy that did not know Spanish was preaching outside of an abortion clinic. And there was a Mexican couple who were about to abort their baby. And they understood what that man was preaching. Now, I don't know what God did, whether God gave that man the ability to speak Spanish or whether God opened their ears to understand what that man was saying. Either way, it was a gift of language, right? And they did not abort the baby. And they came back holding the baby up, crying and in tears, talking to that guy through an interpreter. And the guy didn't even catch on. He's like, "Okay, good. I'm glad. That's why we're here, to save babies, you know, to save people from doing a murderous deed, you know." And as he walked away, he's like, "Wait a minute. How did they understand me?" And so he went back, spoke through the interpreter. "Could you understand every word I said?" "Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah." And you see, the biggest miracle wasn't so much the tongues, it was the fact that that baby got saved. Isn't that the greatest miracle?
Yes.
I mean, we could major on the tongue issue, but the real miracle was the salvation of that baby and that couple that was delivered from murdering their own child. Right?
But Brian, a cessationist wouldn't deny that.
Some would.
Well, if they are, they're wrong.
Because yeah,
a
amen.
Cessationist
good point.
Knows that God does miracles today. God does yeah. heal people.
I guess
it's
we could say
that gift isn't for yeah. individuals for the church today, but it does happen.
Yeah. I guess we could say there's different degrees
yeah.
of cessationists, right? Because
yes,
some of us
cessationists that I know would not agree with that.
Some of us have been around full blown cessationists.
Yeah.
Where others
like a hyper-Calvinist.
Other of us are more milder in that approach. Like we've already admitted there's no apostles capital A. And everyone in this room has admitted that, thank God. And, you know, and also we've admitted that there's no more writing of scripture. So even the most mildest Christian in this area has to be somewhat a mild cessationist, right?
Right.
You might, in a spiritual sense, you might still be eating a higher grade of chili, but you're still, you know, you're still a cessationist if you read it correctly. You have to be, because there's no more writing of scripture and there's no more apostles, capital A. Amen. Now, that's a good point. We don't want to misrepresent people. And I think that's important that we don't do that.
I've been accused of that myself.
Sure.
I've been accused that I didn't believe that the Holy Spirit worked today because I didn't believe the gifts worked for today.
Sure.
And that's false.
Yeah.
I believe that those things happen. I don't believe that there's gifts given to men to sure. healers.
Yeah.
Or I don't believe that tongues are for today, mm-hmm. but they can happen, and they do.
Yeah, sure,
that's
good.
God can do anything. He can heal somebody. He can make somebody speak in an unknown tongue to somebody else that knows it.
Yeah.
It's being interpreted. But the gibberish in the church that happens,
sure.
it's not being translated.
Mm-hmm.
Is
the public practice even if tongues were real today, right? When you look at how it's practiced in 1 Corinthians 14, it has to be practiced orderly and correct. And so when you look at what Scripture says, I know I went to a church that departed from the proper use of the gift. Like, even if we believe we had the gift, we were not following Scripture in the display of it. Because, you know, we would scare people. We would gather together and hum, da, 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 you know, and people would run out the building if they were there for the first time. And they were like, we don't want to be around this craziness. And it scares people. And it's a clanging gong and a tinkling cymbal, because it's not operating in love. And
also the gifts are to edify the body.
Yes.
And when somebody goes up in front of the church and speaks in tongues and nobody can understand it, who is it edifying? Is it edifying the body, or is it edifying the individual?
The only reason why that would edify someone, if it was a genuine gift of tongues, if someone Scottish was present and they're hearing someone talk in real Scottish, they're like,
absolutely.
Wow.
And that would be the interpreter.
Yeah, amen. And that's happened sometimes in the church.
It happens, it's not a regular
occurrence. No, it's not regular that we know of in America. It has been known to happen, like the Apologia ministry event, what they're sharing. And they're definitely not charismatic. They didn't have no axe to grind with that, in the sense that they had nothing to gain from that miracle that occurred, from the standpoint of, see, we were right all along. You know, they weren't approaching it from that standpoint. So notice, though, that now he talks about prophetic powers. If I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge. Oh, we love knowledge, don't we? I mean, let's face it. Knowledge we love. I love knowledge. But if I have all this knowledge and I don't have love, it's not going to benefit me. It's not going to benefit anybody else, because I could be misusing it, and I could be using knowledge to display how intelligent I am instead of wanting to bring glory to Christ through that knowledge.
Wouldn't that correlate too with Matthew 7 when he says, many will come to me saying, we prophesied in your name,
sure,
we cast out demons in your name,
yeah,
we healed the sick in your name.
Yeah.
And he says, I will say to them, depart from me, you worker of iniquity.
Absolutely. Yeah.
It's a similar thing.
No, I think that's an awesome comparison, because 1 Corinthians 13 is talking about that, isn't it? If I have not love and I make all these claims, and the Bible doesn't say by their gifts you will know them, but by their fruit you will know them. Not to say there's no need for gifts, but they have to be operated correctly. Knowledge, and here's another big one, faith. And if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. Now that's a battle, that one, isn't it? Because we so want to have great faith. But if I have great faith and I have no love, it's nothing, according to Paul. And the reason why it's nothing is because I would misuse it. I wouldn't use it correctly. It wouldn't edify anyone. It wouldn't be of benefit. I have a confession to make. I hate the fact that I did watch the Bruce Almighty movie. Forgive me. It was a bad movie. But the one thing I got out of that movie was this. If man had that kind of power, he would be doing all kinds of selfish stuff, wouldn't he?
Yes.
Evan Almighty, another one. That was a better movie than the first one. The first one, I'm confessing my sin when I say I watched it. I shouldn't have watched it. I did. But I did learn a truth from it, that if man had that kind of power, we would be using it for selfish reasons. Moving the moon for the date we're on while causing a tidal wave somewhere else. You know, and of course that was a crazy movie, because he was given power to be God, right? And it was ridiculous. It shows why man cannot be God. One of the many reasons why man cannot be God. Everyone prayed to win the lottery. Do you remember that part of the movie? And he hit click.
Yes.
And they all were miserable. They only won like $2. Yeah, it's like, I've been praying all my life to win the lottery. And I finally win, and I win $2.
Because everybody won.
Yeah, everyone won. Do not watch that movie. I repent publicly of ever watching that movie. I shouldn't have.
I was saved, so I can say so.
Yeah, well, I was saved. I should have known better. The Bible Knowledge Commentary here has on this note, even the gift of prophecy, which Paul championed, is a great gift for the Corinthian church. Now, think about this. He said, on the one hand, I would that you all spoke with tongues, but rather that you prophesy. And then he said, you may all prophesy one by one, that all may be edified and built up. In other words, we may speak from the Lord with language that can be understood, that all may be edified and built up. Isn't it amazing that in our immaturity, we've often emphasized tongues more than prophecy, and Paul was wanting to correct the Corinthians and say, hey, there is this one gift every believer can have. You may all prophesy one by one. And what is prophecy? It's foretelling what is on the heart and mind of God. I too have the Holy Spirit, every believer can say. And as you're grounded and learn, you can speak from the heart and mind of God as you compare the burden you're sensing along with Scripture, right? Use the sword of the Spirit, the Word of God. 1 Corinthians 14:1. Let's go there. 1 Corinthians 14:1. Let's look at that. Pursue love and earnestly desire the spiritual gifts. Yes. Especially that you may prophesy. For one who speaks in the tongue speaks not to men but to God, for no one understands him, but he utters mysteries in the Spirit. On the other hand, the one who prophesies speaks to people for their upbuilding and encouragement and consolation. I was looking for the verse, you may all prophesy one by one, that all may be edified, right? Amen. It's in there somewhere. But
so the next one.
Next one, thank you. Sure.
So for he that speaketh in an unknown tongue speaketh not unto men but unto God. So is that the is an unknown tongue like
a, possible?
Like not a language.
Some would say it was, but another idea is it when there was no interpreter present, right? It's possible because I was wondering how long. After Pentecost, like Corinthian church practiced this gift of tongues, right? And there was an interpreter present usually. And they said, you know, if there's no interpreter present, then you speak quietly before God and yourself. So there was a real gift of tongues, whether it's what we're practicing today. That's the one up for debate, isn't it? Is what we have now, what they had then, and there's some debate there.
Yeah. Gibberish, you know, because it
and we don't want to offend anyone here by using the word gibberish.
No, I agree with that.
Yeah,
well.
Yeah.
You're right.
Yeah, we don't want to offend anyone.
But it is something that nobody understands, right?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, it is. So even if like it's a genuine gift, you're supposed to use it before yourself
but
and God.
In verse 4.
That's the thing that liberated me from a lot of this was we weren't practicing it correctly if we believed it was real. And what it did, it relegated the tongues issue to a private thing before God, right? And so it shouldn't even be an issue in a public setting unless God chooses to manifest, which he can, a real gift of tongues, right?
Yep.
He can manifest it as he chooses. I don't think it ceased in that sense. And so I just think there's a lot of misunderstanding on something that is meant to be private, as opposed to public. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And so...
in verse 4, he says, yeah. One who speaks in tongues edifies himself.
Yes.
But one who prophesies edifies...
Builds up the church. Now I want you all... Yeah, there it is, Mickey. Verse 5, right? Now, I want you all to speak in tongues, but even more to prophesy. The one who prophesies is greater than the one who speaks in tongues, unless someone interprets so that the church may be built up. Because if someone does have a genuine gift of tongues, they're speaking in a language that they have never learned, and someone says, hey, I'm Italian, or I'm French, and they're speaking good French, and let me interpret that for you. Then that would be...
We can't say that that never happened.
No, because I don't have universal...
That's right.
And I think that's why we remain open, because if God can give a donkey the gift of tongues, which he did, I've never saw that as a gift of tongues before, but it really is. Because he gave that donkey ability to speak human language and understand and even win an argument against Balaam.
Yep.
So I hope that never happens to you, Norbert, with Wilson. But if it does, let us know. We'll pray for you. We'll be like, we're worried about Norbert. How many witnesses were there? Was Teresa present when it happened? So anyway, so this is good. Prophecy is a wonderful thing when it's done in love. And that's where the body needs discernment, you know, because we've had people in the past come here, and I love them. I do believe they're authentic believers, but they've been raised a certain way where they come and say, "Thus saith the Lord," and immediately your spirit's like, "It just doesn't feel right. It just doesn't sound right." And because they believe that prophecy is, "Thus saith the Lord," and they're crying out this thing, and it's not, what they're saying isn't in and of itself heresy, but it just doesn't feel right. Do you know what I'm trying to say? Mm-hmm. And I think we should have the freedom to go to that person and say, "I don't think that's how you're supposed to practice that gift in that way." The biggest thing I got from that statement is, "I know you're reading the King James Bible. Thus saith the Lord." And some very loving Christians practice that, right? I'm not going to doubt that person's Christianity. I was raised around that stuff myself. It's more the background in which someone is raised. And we have to find a way to nurture these people, to guide them in the right direction, to teach them more correctly on prophecy. You know what I mean? Like Priscilla and Aquila taught Apollos, who was a great, mighty teacher. They taught him the way more perfectly, right? Because he was only educated up to the baptism of John the Baptist. He had never heard about the other stuff. Yet he was a mighty man in the scriptures. And we know he was a great teacher because he learned from Priscilla and Aquila. Because a person who wants knowledge, they don't care where they're going to get it from. We stay teachable. Unless it's from a dog. No, I'm kidding. My dog teaches me stuff all the time, not verbally, but I learn things about myself and my impatience. Paul championed as a great gift for the Corinthian church, prophecy, are the gifts of wisdom and knowledge and faith. But they were nothing compared with love. You take love out of the equation, these gifts cease to be. I think the biggest thing that perhaps we've seen, because we are a church that loves knowledge, right? We love knowledge, don't we? But we've seen at times, in myself, I've seen at times where I'd misused that knowledge, you know, because I've not operated in love, right? And I've gone away thinking, I'm thinking to know how smart I am. And that's when we get corrected, because every gift that we might have is meant to bring glory to Jesus Christ,
amen.
Right? And so that's just one example how a gift can be used incorrectly. There are those who do have the gift of knowledge, but they misuse that gift. And we look at them and think, if only God could pour into their life the love of God's Spirit. We see such potential, and it could still happen. And so we pray that God use the knowledge they have and use it for his glory, right? There's hope yet. We're all... wrongly motivated.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah.
They want the attention brought to them.
Yes.
Not to God.
That's true. And that's where, even with prophecy in a church setting, you're like, oh, you know, you can't pick fault with perhaps what's being said, but you know it's not being done correctly.
Right.
And Paul was not this. Depreciating those gifts, but was appreciating love by showing it to be incomparable. So, now 1 Corinthians 13:3. Let's go here quickly. Now again, charitable works, great thing. Gift of helps, helping people, being a giver. That's a spiritual gift too. But notice that Paul even says, if I give away all I have, and if I deliver up my body to be burned, even if I give my very life, but have not love, I gain nothing. Nothing. That's incredible when you consider the cost involved here, where there's no love. Matthew 6:2. Let's go there real quick, and then Jesus warns us about this. He warns us about the motive of why we give to the needy. Do we give, and do we only give when people see us giving? Do we make sure someone sees us? Especially with cell phones today, you know, could you keep recording this, you know, and you, thus, when you give to the needy, sound no trumpet before you, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may be praised by others. So that's motivation, isn't it? Motivation. Truly, I say to you, they have received their reward. So the reward of other people saying, what a great guy. You see what he just did? You know, they already have their reward when they do that. Cell phones are awesome. Cool. He gives his beloved sleep. It's wonderful. But 1 Corinthians 13:4-5 here. Love is patient. Remember that as you're having to endure this sermon. Love is patient and kind. So qualities there. Patient, kind. Love does not envy or boast. You know, we will grow as a church when you and I, we're all in this for the glory of God, right? And that's when we forget about ourselves. And that's when, if we're in it for the glory of God, envy, boasting doesn't happen, rudeness, you know, we're able to overlook all that, even if it does manifest, because we're here for the glory of God, not for our own interests. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. I mean, we're a part of a body here, so we have to learn to work together, don't we? It is not irritable or resentful. Yeah, sometimes we get that way. But the love of God gets rid of those times that we feel that way. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. So the fruit of the Spirit, love, never ends. The fruit of the Spirit you have in you, you will have for all eternity. Think about that. The spiritual gifts that we have to be used by God, we have them temporarily until we fulfill the Great Commission. The Great Commission comprises of bringing the lost to salvation and discipling believers to be more like Jesus. Those two aspects, I know ministry can sometimes be more, a little more complicated than that, but that's the two scopes of ministry that we're focused on as a church, right? Well, you know, discipling, conversion and discipling, evangelism and teaching, the two necessary elements to keep a church functioning correctly. The teachers should not look down on the evangelists, and the evangelists should not look down on the teachers. We have different gifts, not to say that just because I'm not an evangelist, Paul writing to Timothy said, do the work of an evangelist, amen? Preach the gospel to all, and be ready to share his word with others. But this is one that is sometimes misused, in my opinion, and you can disagree with me on that, and that's fine. This is not where we're going to have our unity around, right? But this is my opinion here. I bring this up. Love never ends. As for prophecies, they will pass away. Here's the thing. It doesn't say they have passed away. It says they will pass away. I know cessationists use this verse to support their idea, you know, that there's no more prophecy. As for tongues, they will cease. Do you know there's coming a day when we're in heaven, we'll all speak the same language again? There'll be no need for a gift of tongues. There will be no need for prophecy because we would have fully arrived and prophecy would all be fulfilled. Every scripture would be fulfilled. Here's another thing. There'll be no more need for scripture. Yeah. Scripture will never pass away because it's fulfilled, but you're not going to be walking around with Bibles in heaven. It's gone. The living word is there.
Was it Huss that prophesied that 100 years later one would come, which was Martin Luther?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, a goose.
Yeah.
He was a goose, and he prophesied that a swan would come. And he said, him you will not destroy. And that's why they say if you go to these Lutheran churches, they have their pulpits are designed like a swan. Yeah, right, right as he's about to be burned at the stake, he prophesies that. He says, you may burn this goose, because his name Huss means goose. Burn the goose. But the swan, you're not going to be able to touch. And that came to pass because they wanted to murder Luther. They hated Martin Luther. They hated him and did everything they could to destroy him. But God's protection was on him and he couldn't hurt him. And he said, as he's going to the diet of worms or worms, I like the diet of worms. It makes it sound like you eat worms. He said, as he's going in, he says, though there be as many devils as tiles on the rooftops in Worms, I am going to Worms. And he went. And he had his moment of weakness. You know, he said, give me a night to pray about it. And that's when he came back and he said, my warrant is the word of God. I can do naught else except go by, and I'm butchering the quote, but he said, you know, I'm going to stand on the word of God. And that was where he gave that famous quotation. Yeah. And then he wrote the Bible into German from the original Hebrew Greek, which I think was the greatest gift he gave to the German nation.
Amen. I want to know if you agree with this. I used to think all the time when I get to heaven, I'm going to have so many questions, but we won't, right? Because we'll know everything. That's why you say
we'll still be learning,
yeah.
Because we're in the presence of infinite greatness. But you will be beholding perfection. I think the questions we have now probably won't matter. You know, when you have people say, well, when I get to heaven, I want to ask Jesus all these things.
Yeah.
One example is Job. Job had all these questions for God. And when God showed up, he said, I placed my hand over my mouth. I've spoken like a fool. Because a lot of our questions will be completely irrelevant. When, in fact, if not all of them, yeah. When we see Jesus face to face. Because we'll realize that not only did I not have the answer to the question, I had the wrong questions, you know,
yeah, <that's true.
laughs> if that makes sense.
Yes.
Hope that helps.
Yes.
Yeah. So love never ends. As for prophecies, they will pass away. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will pass away. A good friend of mine, and Butch knows who it is, he often uses this as a good example of why the cessationist wrongly used this text. And he got me on that today and on Facebook. He said, knowledge has passed away. He's joking about it, you know, because knowledge hasn't passed away. And when a cessationist reads this and they read it through a biased lens, they're going to say it's all passed away except for knowledge. So you can see the misuse. It's going to. Even the knowledge we currently have is going to pass away. The current theological understandings we have, there'll be no need for that when we go to see Jesus, because there we have perfection. And this is what he talks about in the next part here, almost done. 1 Corinthians 13, 9 through 10. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part, but when the perfect comes, the partial will pass away. The perfect that's coming is not the King James Version. It's Jesus Christ. He's the perfect. Why do we know it's not the King James Version? We love the King James, but it's not perfect. There's no perfect English translation. No matter how much they strive to be literal, the King James has its faults, as does the New American Standard, as does the ESV, as does the NIV. They all have their areas of weakness. But we have the word of God in it, right? It's there.
Yes.
So the perfect that comes is not the Bible, it's Jesus Christ. And when he comes, the partial will pass away. And this is why. Whoops, I gave it twice there. And this might help too, Jolene, this thought here. In comparing, because I do believe that's what he's doing here. In our current status, we're like children trying to understand, right? Compared to eternity. We're not in eternity yet. And we're like children. And if you have a child, their question is legitimate. And you're thinking about, you're like, how do I word it to them where they can understand it? Because they're missing it on the question part even. But he said, when I was a child, I spoke like a child. I fought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I gave up childish ways. And I think he's jabbing at the Corinthians with that too, you know. Make love the most important thing. But notice, I think he also has an idea here where he could be talking about our current status of understanding. We're like children trying to understand compared to what's coming. For now, we see in the mirror dimly. Isn't that our current status? What we're seeing is correct, but it's limited. It's dimly. But then, face to face, oh, it's going to happen. When we see Jesus face to face, there'll be no need for the dim mirror anymore. The dim mirror, by the way, is Scripture. The mirror is Scripture. James calls it a mirror. Looking in the mirror, forgetting who we are, just being hearers and not doers of the word, right? So the mirror is God's word. But then face to face, now I know in part, then I shall know fully. And I like this next part. Even as I have been fully known. Isn't that wonderful? You look back on your life when you're with him face to face and you will realize you have been fully known by the Lord all this time. He knew you. He knew you perfectly. All of your imperfections, who you were, and you will marvel how much the Lord has known you and been with you all this time. And so let's look at this. And again, he's talking about the importance, the difference of importance here. We need faith, don't we? The just shall live by faith, right? We need it. But he says, so now faith, hope, and love abide, these three, but the greatest of these is love. Love believes all things. Love hopes all things, right? If you have love, the love of God, you have faith and you have hope. But it's possible for us to have faith and hope without love, and it becomes kind of worthless in that sense. So I'll close here, guys. But any thoughts on what we've been looking at tonight? Hopefully it was helpful.
Yes, good.
Hopefully it helped.
I would encourage anyone with the tongues issue, one way or the other,
sure,
to study it all the way through,
yeah,
into chapter 14.
Amen.
Because it clarifies that tongues were actually a sign of judgment.
In some cases, yeah.
It mm-hmm. actually was in all mm-hmm. Scripture.
In Babel.
It even talks about it in 14,
mm-hmm.
In 21 and 22. But I'm just sure. saying, just study it out.
Yeah, no, it's interesting. I know when I studied chapter 14, it really helped me to realize that, you know, I'd been raised where it had been wrongly practiced, you know, and so it kind of led me in the right way with that issue.
Yeah, Isaiah deals with it, and so does...
Yeah. 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 And still they will not listen to me. Another thought there. Yeah. They will still not listen to me. Well, guys, let's close in prayer if there is nothing else here. We thank you. It's been an eventful day. TJ, would you mind closing in prayer, sir? Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I just want to thank you for this time.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Foremost is our relationship to grow with you. So, Lord, just keep teaching us, guide us, protect us. And, Lord, let your word grow in our hearts and minds. And let us be a light in this world to others. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, guys.